mine. I live in Bunnik, so that's nearby here. I can walk to the office. It's a bit of a convenience. And I play the piano. Unfortunately, I don't have a vleugel. What is that in a concert piano? Grand piano. I only have a stand. What is it? Normal piano. Maybe that's something for the office to acquire, a simple piano, then we can... actually, Joran was mentioning the penthouse, and then I got a comment, is there a hot tub? Not yet, okay. Tomorrow we will do that. All right, so this is all common knowledge to you, why infrastructure as code, because clicking in Portal is boring and error prone. Anyone still clicking in Portal? Maybe that's, maybe you are too shy and we can discuss during the break. I'm still clicking in Portal, so to start your infrastructure and to explore, and sometimes it is too hard to make infrastructure as code, and use case and the time and the budget does not meet the timelines. So then, and yeah, if it's not repeatable, then why should you do it in infrastructure as code? But it is preferred. Source control, enable collaboration, repeatability, scalability, disaster recovery. So I believe all the teams are common to you, so you can imagine that you can work together on the infrastructure, and you can ask reviews with your coworkers, and together, because it's all coded in a Git repo, you can raise pull requests, and you can use the common Git validation mechanisms to review your stuff. And you can copy paste. So if you have one .NET app and you deploy it, and then the next team pops up and it wants the same infrastructure, then copy paste and voila. Disaster recovery. So always the discussion. I'm not sure if anyone can comment on that, but always when we talk to customers, do we need multiple regions? So always the customer starts in West Europe or North Europe. And then the question pops up, what happens when Amsterdam gets bombed by the Russians? So is it plausible that you would recover in Ireland? Is it a valid use case? We do not think so, because if Amsterdam is stopped, then the Dutch economy stops. But you never know. So maybe anyone has a valid a use case to have this disaster recovery in place? No one. Great. That was the confirmation I was looking for. No, joking. Let's see. So next slide is about the Azure ecosystem. So before we talk about Terraform, we need to know what are the other tools available. And obviously, PowerShell commandlets and the AZ CLI, it's procedural, and you still need to run to read through top to bottom, and it is not declarative, and it is not easy to understand. Then you have Bicep, and I'm not sure, is anyone favoring Bicep? 3, 4, 5, favoring Bicep compared to Terraform, or is Terraform better? Yeah, I understand. Bicep, of course, we prefer Bicep above Azure Resource Manager templates. I have a slide included to talk about Bicep compared to Terraform at the end. And of course, there are more tools than on this slide, like Ansible. What is Terraform actually? So everyone has used Terraform already, so you all know that it's just an executable. You can run everywhere. It's Linux, it's Windows, it can run in containers, it can run on virtual machines, it can run on your laptop, everything the same. So that's cool. But you need to learn HashiCorp configuration language. So it comes with its own language. Why should you use Terraform? So marketing slide included. actually, a couple of themes resonate with me, the multi-provider thing. And so you see at the bottom of this slide, the infrastructure partners, what is really key that the Terraform community provides is all these pluggable providers. So either Amazon, Google, or Azure DevOps, or Topdesk, or whatever tool you are would like to provision, there is a provider out there. If it's not, you can build it. There is an SDK Azure Core provides. You can easily. You need to learn Go. There's also a .NET community effort to build to build providers. So that's a strong thing, and you see that there is a strong adoption in the market space around Terraform. The what if functionality is common knowledge. Let's say anything else I would like to address. We will see. All right. The default, the standard workflow, the init plan apply. I think I will skip the demo. Of course, we should be cautious about adopting some technologies without taking note of any downsides. So the story goes that if you take the native tooling from the cloud provider like Microsoft, you'll be always you have this so-called zero-day support. So there's some innovation, and then same day you can apply it. Well, I will tell you about some solutions in this area to address that. But indeed, the so-called convenience provider that Microsoft is providing together with HashiCorp has some lag, and not all innovation is available. Right. And always take note: is it sensible to put your desired state into Terraform? Is it not sensible to use other tooling? So, for example, deploying .NET applications, should you use Terraform to do that? Yeah. I don't think so. State file. So also common knowledge, I guess. That's really crucial for your Terraform workflow. If you use Microsoft native tooling, then Azure is your state. So you don't have to manage a state separately. But with Terraform, you need to create a blob container, and you need to configure your Terraform backend. And any execution will flow into that state file, and yeah, sometimes it's a puzzle how to cope with changes and how to split your state file whenever your requirements change. So I guess state file management is still a opportunity for partners or HashiCorp itself. Yeah, and of course remote state storage. So it's easy to do local state, but yeah, then when your laptop disappears, then also your state is gone. So good luck with recovery. Always do this in a blob container. All right, deploying at scale. So far, any questions? When you deploy at scale, whenever you need to transition from manual to automation. So in the initial inception, you only have your laptop, your privileged workstation. You need to run some commands to set up the blob container, set up your service principles in Azure DevOps, your service connections. When that's over, you can roll out your platform. And the platform consists of, we will talk more about that, your management group hierarchy, your policies, your connectivity, your virtual network, you know. On top of that, you will be providing landing zones. So you can imagine you have this centralized platform with hub connectivity with, for example, a data center on in another region with some private cloud. That's your central hub. And it's connected with various spokes, the hub spoke model. So every team gets its own landing zone, its own subscription. And in this subscription, it gets some authorization to do stuff like deploying Kubernetes workloads or do some machine learning. So all kinds of landing zones must be provisioned. And in this stage, you only do the foundation. So most importantly, the network connectivity. But you could also imagine some key vault, a standard key vault, whatever. On top of that, the specific landing zone resources, like what I said. So the one landing zone gets its Kubernetes, the other landing zone, it's data factories. And these top layers are responsibility of the landing zone team or app team, spoke team. And top layer, I dashed the Terraform state thing because I think in most cases, the top layer is done by some other tooling, like the regular .NET deployments or Helm charts, GitOps thing with the Kubernetes. Any questions about this slide? All right. Anyone familiar with the enterprise scale module that Microsoft provides? Two hands, three hands. Right. So maybe it's a luxurious position that Cloud Nation has. We mainly deal with customers that are new to public cloud. So we have greenfield opportunities. And whenever you have greenfield, you can set your own standards. Microsoft has this cloud adoption framework. Within the cloud adoption framework, Microsoft has laid out lots of guidelines. And it's cool to see that sometimes they hit the bullet. With this enterprise scale module, we think occasionally we hit the requirements. And with this enterprise scale module is a it's owned by Microsoft. It's published to the Terraform public registry, so you can easily consume it in your own Terraform workloads. What is in the box? On the sheet, you see some grayed out areas that's not in the box. It's done with other means. What is in the box is what is colored. Mouse cursor. Yeah, so the management group hierarchy, how do you put your subscriptions in your enterprise into a tree structure? And a management group structure is important for your policies. So you have, for example, the SAP area that is highly privileged, highly secured. The online area is allowed public IPs to allow public traffic, for example. So that's why the management group topology is important. Thirdly, the management resources, mainly log analytics workspace, centrally deployed. And lastly, connectivity resources. I would like to discuss that a bit more in detail and show you some code. Actually, there's quite some flavors in the box. So, for example, virtual wide area network. Anyone familiar with virtual wide area network service? 1, 2, 3, 4. Cool. Microsoft is trying to deliver everything as a service. That's nice. So you don't need to do any manual configuration and plug separate components together. Let's show a bit about virtual wide area network and in combination with ExpressRoute. The challenge is to switch to the right environment. I was also very pleased with some approvals from customers, so I'm able to show you their tenant. We can discuss during drinks what their use cases are. All right, so Virtual One is a Azure resource, as maybe you would expect that. In a Virtual One, you have a couple of features like ExpressRoute circuits. ExpressRoute circuit is someone who needs to help bigger. So this is all right. Nothing to see here, just a line. What can I show you? The ExpressRoute circuit in this case connects the Azure virtual network with an on-premise data center. And ExpressRoute is a service you will need to acquire through a network partner like Vodafone. It's a highly high bandwidth connection. The virtual hub concept. So the virtual hub there, the virtual networks are connected. Briefly, hopefully this will yield some results. So every spoke gets its own virtual network and it gets peered through the virtual hub in the virtual one. And the routing is taken care of, so the traffic flows through firewall, through express route. Talking about firewall, I need to scroll a bit. So here you all see the VNets and all downwards somewhere, not sure where. The firewall is hidden. Maybe in the hub, I'm not sure. Maybe someone can help me while I struggle here. So let's take a look at the code. Good luck with finding where to look. All right. The module concept of Terraform. So the module is a reusable building block. Modules can live in the public registry from that you can publish to. Modules can live locally. In this case, the module lives publicly. Here you have the reference. Actually, I would also like to share the documentation. I guess best starting point is the wiki. So that you see the same picture I reused. And good luck with ingesting all these guidance. The module requires some input parameters. Mainly the let's focus on the connectivity input. So somewhere is the, buried the input variable for parameters for managing your connectivity. Hopefully I can look it, I can find it, or else here it is. Configure connectivity resources. It's referring to a local. Let's look up the local. As you may know, Terraform has this folder semantics, so every file in the same folder is in the same module. Let's see that, I believe we can look into this. So here you see the reference local, and you need to set up a big bag of properties. So would you like a hub network? Yes, I would like that. Would I like a virtual one? Yeah, for this time, okay. Let's see if there's anything else, I believe. So no VPN gateway, but we would like to have an express route. So, and please give me a firewall. So it's a bit, I find it quite a polished experience actually. I must note this just provisions the resources, but the configuration top must still be provisioned separately. Any questions? Would you like to see anything else at this point? Let's go back. Did I plan anything else here? Put pin. All right, a complex scenario because I promised some advanced stuff. Anyone familiar with private endpoints? Wow, almost everyone. I thought we did public cloud, boys. Why private endpoints? That's a bit, and you see that Microsoft did a bet on public endpoints way back, and they still struggle with private endpoints. It's way harder than it should be. If you do AWS, then you think Microsoft had gone mad. But anyways, I tried to explain the DNS resolution flow, if required, or is everyone familiar with DNS? The private link DNS resolution flow. Hopefully it's readable, it's 5 steps. So maybe I can show you that on a virtual machine in a private network. I believe this step was prepared and then this, a disconnect. Hopefully it will reconnect. Can anyone tell me why this error happens. No one can. Microsoft is, I believe, not did not anticipate this error. Do you see that it is only containing localization labels? Strange. Anyways, I believe I can recover by refresh this. And then hopefully I will log in. So cool, the Key Vault integration that has landed last year or so. Hopefully we get virtual machine connectivity. If not, the widescreen, terrible. Oh, why isn't there a progress bar? Who did forget that? Okay, I prepared an endpoint. In this case, is it readable? Also to the guys at the back. All right. So a SQL server in this case. Marked on the top of the screen is the how would you call that? The public domain name. And what is the trick that Microsoft applies? If you are in a private network, then you query against. I was hoping actually that it was visible here. Is it here visible? You query against. Oh, that's very small, right? Not sure if I can zoom in. Where is the zoom? There it goes. So this is the Azure DNS that's sitting in your private network, waiting for requests. And whenever you hit that Azure DNS, it will forward requests to any connected DNS zones. And in this case, before it queries the private DNS zones, it will first query some internal registry, not sure. That internal registry will yield an alias, the private link alias. And that private link alias will be queried against connected private DNS zones. And finally, ultimately, because that record is in your private DNS zone, it will return the correct IP address for that endpoint. So hopefully that was in a nutshell steps 1-5. To set this all up is a bit involved. How many private DNS zones are required, man? How many Azure resource types are there? It's not hundreds, but it is tens. Are we are we repeating ourselves? Are we all building Terraform code to provision those DNS zones? Maybe Microsoft can help with this enterprise scale module. So let's see if I can find it. In this case, again, you see the same, this is readable, right? The same module reference from the public registry. And we will zoom into the DNS settings. It's also part of the connectivity configuration. So let's see if we can find it. Hey, a DNS entry. Hey, we enable it. So it's a bit of exploration, reading the documentation, and then actually let's dig into the source code of the module. Why not? Because code is a documentation, right? No comments. I find it quite charming how this module is laid out. So in the core, they have this resources files. And you think, are there any DNS zones? Hope I cannot find it now. Quickly, maybe here. So you need to find your way into the space, the spot where this module is provisioning the resource type you would like to see. And then you can reverse engineer if it's part of the module. And of course, documentation. So I tend to do both ways. Try to understand the documentation, try to understand the code. and then fiddle further. So whenever this is enabled, it will loop through all these resource types you activate. And for every resource type you activate, it will provision a private DNS zone. And I have prepared the plan. And I can read the plan into PrettyPlan. And I can show you. So this is the JSON, you know. And the module indeed creates a plan for all those private DNS zones. Yeah, that's fantastic, right? And it's open source. So anyone who spots a gap can contribute. I like that. It goes on and on and on. What else? So platform team ready, right? Well, it's only part of the story because landing zone team kicks in. So of course you do agile. So first day you deploy all the private DNS zones. Second day, good luck to your application team. You can go ahead. They say, hey, I need to add my DNS record to your shared private DNS zones. How can I do that? Well, we cannot grant access because many landing zones will be using the same resource. How can we solve this? So any comments on the from the audience? Is there any solution? I hope. I'm a bit frustrated now. The answer is, well, one of the answers could be Azure Policy. Who is familiar with Azure Policy? Azure Policy is an machinery, how do you say that? Engine, some desired state engine. So you can set the policies, then of course policies come in various flavors, but I would like to focus on the so-called deploy if not exists policies. What happens? It does some conditional checks, and if those conditional checks are met or not met actually, then it will do a deployment to try to resolve those conditions. So in our case, we would like to have DNS records for all private endpoints. So the condition would be, if there's any private endpoint and there's no DNS record, please, dear policy machinery, deploy the DNS records. Make sense? What is very cool about this enterprise scale module, they have a structure for setting up policies. So let's configure together. Archetype, I mentioned it already, but I find it a quite involved terminology. So I relate it to management group types or so. So you could have vision an online platform archetype, and an online platform archetype and allows for public endpoints. An other archetype would be SAP, very privileged with maybe custom keys, you know, what is it? Not managed by Microsoft. All right, so policies, let's dig into the module. So it took me some time, and then finally I was able to find the source in the surprise, surprise, archetypes folder. There is a lib, and there's all these stuff. So in the box, there are policy assignments, policy definitions, set definitions, rule definitions prepared, but you need to specify whether you would like to get them. And you do that with archetype definitions. So there's a set of default archetypes, like the root. In the root, so whenever you deploy the default, these root policies get provisioned. Where is an example? This one, the deploy resource diag. This one takes care of connecting all your resources to the centralized log analytics workspace. It's very convenient, but that was not our mission now. Our mission was DNS. So where is the DNS and why is it not activated by default? I'm not sure if it's, I believe it's in the corp. So there's apparently a out of the box corp archetype, and it comes with the private DNS zone policy. And whenever you have a custom archetype, which we occasionally are using to have a little bit more of a customization, you need to add that reference I've selected to the policy assignments bucket. It's a real reference to a JSON file. So let's find deploy private DNS zones by hand. It's in the policy assignments bucket somewhere. And of course, it's not always, here it is. So this name is the identifier in the .dodo file. Good luck. It's what's the metaphor? Wildland, jungle out there.
Yeah.
So, of course, this is not the whole story because it references a policy policy definition. I thought it was a set. Exactly, a set. So we should expect multiple policies, policy definitions in that set. So and you need to dig deeper and deeper and deeper. So finally, you will find lots of reference policies, every resource type. Now the real story, some resource types are included. I believe only 8, surprisingly. So hopefully someone will take the effort and contribute the remaining resource types to this module. Did I miss anything? I would like to show the thing the policy does. It's buried here. It is this configuration. So I always find it quite hard to translate. So in Azure Portal, it's called X, and in the Azure Resource Manager, it's called Y. So this stuff is called groups, DNS zone groups, whatever. And you can, through code, obviously, you can connect an existing private DNS zone to your private endpoint configuration. And then by magic, the private endpoint backend, which Azure does, it provisions that record, that very record, to the connected private DNS zone. Could I click here? No, yeah. So this record appears magically. That is nice. So the policy provisions the group configuration, the private endpoint provisions the A record. That was what I would like to tell you about. Any questions about this? Was it clear? Modules, I talked about the public registry. So that is the one on the third. You can also set up your private registry. Surprisingly, there is no building block HashiCorp is providing. So there is some community effort, and that you can copy paste, and then you can set up your private registry in your own infrastructure. But regularly you see the Git repo flow. So you can set up a shared Git repo in your organization and put modules, reusable modules over there. And then you can encourage the landing zone teams to start using those shared modules. And to the left, you have this relative folders thing. So in your own workload, you can always think about reusability and refactor accordingly and put stuff in modules. All right, this slide. Is it resonating with you? Occasionally, we have discussions during the design phase. How much configuration are we putting into the module? Are we splitting up? Are we combining? Make sense? lately I'm more a sponsor to the left side because I'm a I'm not sure if I'm experienced, but I'm trying to. So I know what I'm doing. So I tend to use the smaller references to the left. That gives me great flexibility, and I can do some spaghetti, and maybe that's not good. Spaghetti coding. So to the right is maybe a good thing for a little bit less mature teams. Just provide them a super module, and then with simple directives, like in this example, I would like to have a resource group with two storage accounts, and then hide all the details. And so, any comments from the audience? What is your preference? No preference. The middle. You can combine both. Yes, that's true. So let's take a look at the other module Microsoft is providing as part of the Cloud Adoption Framework Terraform Endeavor. And that is called, what is the name? I'm not sure. In this slide, I'm calling it the Azure Super Module. And what I find very strange, one, the module source code is not in the Azure org. It's in the ASTF.org. That's a taken aan de wand. How do you say that? A sign on the wall. Secondly, 9 months already. I'm not sure when version 3 landed. Version 3 is the latest Azure RM provider. When did it land? Last year? Still to date, they are not have not merged version 3 support into the main branch. It's an 9 months already or so, this pull request is open. So what should we do? Should we start using it? Is it good enough for us? Should we fork it? And if you fork source code, then you can change it a bit and optimize it a bit for your use case. Or should we rebuild it? Should we just get inspired by the stuff and then build our own super module? Let's take a look. Challenge, where to find. You can choose which plan should we run. Should we run a V2 plan or a V3 plan? None of both, okay. Let's see. There it is. Why did I call it main TF? What is that convention, you know? Every Terraform module has its main TF. I have 20 tabs open, main TF. Good luck finding your source. All right. So, version 3, I guess. This is the way you reference a Git sourced module. So, in the case of a private Git repo, you need to provide credentials. But in this case, it's a public Git repo, so it just can be downloaded. And you need to reference, in this case, a particular branch because the version 3 support is in that branch. And then you need to provide this object structure. So, it seems reasonable. Let's try to run the plan. Ooh, spooky. Terraform. Can I type plan? Ooh, was that auto completion? I was not sure if I would be showing some GitHub Copilot action today, but I don't think so. But GitHub Copilot surely supports Terraform HCL. So whenever you are typing, you type Kubernetes or what? Then does not generate a full Kubernetes workload, but it generates some lines. So I was discussing with a coworker during dinner, what could you do to improve performance? Because I really hate Terraform CLI performance when it comes to big resource trees. In this case, Supermodule is huge. So you see, I'm talking, and still the plan did not finish. And I got the suggestion, take a look at Terraspace. And I already got a suggestion to take a look at Terragrant, so I'm a bit confused which to pick. So I'm hoping that it is feasible to, let's say, plug and play a bit. Yeah, I find it a workaround. I come from web app development. Web app development is Ctrl+S, poof, websites updated with hot reload, you know. So why is it not designed for hot reloading? I raised the ticket, and it is on their backlog, actually. But it's not high prio, because it works, right? If it works, don't break it. What does it? Yeah. If it ain't broken, don't fix it. So at least one thing I would like to show you, that even on the V3 branch, they are not able to prevent deprecation messages. Why on earth? Microsoft, a $1 billion company. So apparently there's very little staffing on this module. Should we customize it? Should we branch it? Not sure. At least within Cloud Nation, occasionally it pops up and and clients ask for it, and we build our custom thing. So there you have it. For every resource type, we have modules, and we combine it in the same JSON format. Hopefully I can find it. Maybe I can click here. So in this case, let's create application insight, app service plan, Cosmos DB, function app, logic app, standard, global settings, key vault, log analytics, subnets, resource groups, apps, you know, it goes on and on and on. Logic apps again, storage accounts. And how does the plan look like? I believe I wanted to share the plan with you. So I took the preparation. So one big JSON, obviously, again. Is there some counter? How many resources? Is this all? Maybe is this not the right... Seems the right plan. So everything good. So it all depends on your requirements. Is this something you are keen to implement? And then, you know, maybe it's depending on the maturity of the landing zone teams. I believe any team can maintain their own infrastructure with this layout. One caveat obviously is whenever a new feature is required, you need to plug your new module. It takes some engineering. Make sense? Okay. 10 minutes left, right? I thought I had 60 minutes. Okay, then I will wrap up. The story about AZ API, should I show it? Not sure. Time is up. The Azure RM provider is a convenience layer. It's always lagging behind. So whenever an innovation is required like this, the Logic App resource does not facilitate workload deployments, you know, the Logic App definitions. And you can switch to AZ API. And wow, what is it comparable to Bicep? It's just the exact same properties, the exact same resource type declaration. Yeah. So what is possible with Azure Resource Manager is possible with the AZ API module. And they recently added resource actions. That was a missing one. So whenever you need, in this case, it's a post, an HTTP post at the back end. In this case, you can execute an HTTP post to acquire the callback URL for the logic. I can skip this because Leo will talk you through YAML pipelines. With the free tooling, free in the sense, the licenses you already have, you know, you pay for Azure pipelines. Why should you pay for any other platforms to manage your Terraform? So that is really depending on your requirements. Many customers of ours do not require any additional platforms. But for example, versioning is very fancy in Terraform Cloud. So whenever you have done 5-6 deployments, you can always trace back what happened and what's the root cause of failure. All kinds of suggestions. Tools. Yep. Hopefully I can inspire you with some names here. Take a look at Azure Terrify. Azure Terrify is a Microsoft tool to import existing infrastructure. It's quite, I believe it just needs a dash of extra integration, but it's already usable. Firewall rules can be imported, you know, virtual machine configurations, etc. The comparison, maybe not a surprise, but I'm very fond of Terraform. So I'm not sure why we still should take a look at Bicep. I believe it's a sinking ship. Stop with that. They are already 1 or 2 years on the way to provide multi-providers. So still you cannot provision any Azure Active Directory things, service principles, app registrations, groups. You cannot do that with Bicep. So why should Microsoft still invest in that platform? We will learn. Then I will skip the CDK. I'm really fond of, I cannot skip it. I will not run it, but I will show you the code, hopefully. So CDK stands for Cloud Development Framework. It's something AWS is doing for ages already. And HashiCorp jumped on this wagon, took the open source bits of AWS and built their own Terraform CDK. So in any language of choice, Python, .NET, TypeScript, Go, PowerShell is in the making, you can build your Terraform infrastructure. So in this example, you see TypeScript. So it just, in TypeScript, it's just a matter of importing the resources and then do your stack definitions. And ultimately, it generates a Terraform plan, and you can execute the plan against your infrastructure. So I'm hoping for technology convergence. Why should we make these decisions? It should be all the same, right? That is, I believe, my closing of this talk. Thanks for your attention.